Dr. Stein is a Holocaust survivor that has experienced firsthand what can happen when people fail to do something. And he knows how dangerous it is when society doesn't stand up and speak out. Dr. Stein was born in Czechoslovakia 2 years before the Nazi occupation of Prague to a Jewish father and a Catholic mother. His father was forced into a slave labor camp and later was deported to Terezin, a work and death camp, where he was fortunate enough to survive. His father's family of nine were all killed in concentration camps. During the war, Dr. Stein attended a school where pictures of Adolf Hitler and the German flag hung in every classroom. He dealt with anti-Semitism and lived through air raid drills and bombings by Allied aircrafts. Dr. Stein has witnessed unimaginable hate, but he has chosen to live his life as a survivor, not as a victim. He chooses to tell his story so that people will learn from the tragic history and understand that the Holocaust did not have to happen. We have the power to prevent hate from resulting in tragedy and evil. You will have the opportunity to ask questions at the end of Dr. Stein's talk. So if you have something you would like to hear more about, you'll have the opportunity to ask later. We are honored to be joined today by an incredible person. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Peter Stein.
Thank you. Thank you for the lovely introduction. I can't top it. Maybe I should stop now and just sit down. Thank you very much. Congratulations for being here. I was here for the morning session about, I haven't used a crayon for quite a while, so I really appreciate it. And you should know that the hot area in publishing for people around my age are coloring books for older folks. Apparently, people really enjoy it. And I did, although I only have one color, so I buy the whole box. I want to thank Christy and the high energy people from 4-H for organizing this and this morning's session. And thank you for being here. I know from the program that you did democracy yesterday. And I'm sure you know that democracy is an ongoing process. You don't do it once. You have to be vigilant. You have to keep doing it over and over and over again. And I'm reminded of two quotes that are in your program. One by Albert Einstein, the famous scientist who fled Nazi Germany. And he said, the world is too dangerous to live in, not because of the people who do evil, but because of the people who sit and let it happen. In other words, people who stand by. And in my presentation, I'll talk about bystanders, folks who can't get involved. So getting involved is a key piece of democracy. But I also want to quote Martin Luther King, the civil rights leader and Nobel Prize winner. Quote, life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? So the idea of community, the idea of teamwork, the idea of working together above and beyond individualism is very important. So what I want to do this morning is to talk to you a little bit about a place and a democratic country, Czechoslovakia, where too many good people didn't do enough. They stood by. I'm a sociologist at the University of North Carolina, also called a Targheels. And I'm at the Institute on Aging there. And I'm also a member of the Chapel Hill Durham Holocaust Speakers Bureau. And what we do, about 12 of us, is go to middle schools, high schools, and colleges and talk about our experiences. So this is Czechoslovakia. The red, white, and blue was borrowed from the United States flag. Our president was a friend of Woodrow Wilson, and you'll see Czechoslovakia on the left, and Prague is the city where I was born, right there. And Terezin was a concentration camp where all of my Jewish relatives were sent, and most were sent from Terezin to Auschwitz in Poland and died. So this is where my parents and I lived. This is my room right up there. Yes, it's a joke. But have any of you ever been to Prague? Really? Did you have a good time?
Beautiful city.
Wonderful. Did you bring good walking shoes?
Yeah.
Excellent. A lot of cobblestone. So it's a neat place. So after you graduate high school or college, get one of your rich relatives to take you. It's really worth it. And this is the Charles Bridge, a walking bridge in the middle of Prague. And this is the river called Vltava in Czech, Moldavian, German, where I learned how to swim and also to ice skate. And there are a number of good Czech players in the National Hockey League, some of whom learned how to skate on that river. This is a picture of the Stein family. So my father was Jewish, my mother was Catholic. It was an interreligious marriage. And the Jewish side of the family was quite large. And here's part of the family in 1912, that is before World War I, on a beach in Germany, of all places. The tragic that's hidden in this photograph is of all these people at the beach, only two survived the Holocaust. My dad, who's in a sailor outfit, and Emma, my aunt, who later on married a Protestant gentleman, so she survived. My grandfather and grandmother, the grandfather Joseph died before the Nazi occupation. My grandmother Sophie was a type 1 diabetic. She was sent to Terezin. The Nazis confiscated her diabetes, her insulin, and she died of diabetes in 19 days. It must have been a terrible death. My aunt Carla, my aunt Kamala, that's me in the middle, there's Kamala, and my favorite uncle Richard, who would always bring me toys. He was married but didn't have any kids, so you could rely on him. All of these members of the family were arrested, sent to Terezin, and sent to Auschwitz. So in a span of about 5 months, my father's entire family was wiped out. They just disappeared. I was quite young. I was a young boy when all of this happened. And I always asked, well, what happened to Aunt Kamala, Carla? Where's my Uncle Richard? When is my next toy coming in? And I was always told, well, they're traveling, they're away, they'll come back soon. But of course, they never did. This is a happier day in 1934, where my parents, my dad Victor, and my mother Helen married. And his parents are in the forefront. They married not in a church, not in a temple, but City Hall. And it's a mixed religion marriage. And it turned out a number of Jewish men in Prague married Christian women, which later would help to save their lives. My dad was a businessman. He made things out of bent wood. So if you imagine this chair made out of wood, all the curved pieces, they made skis, they made tennis rackets, they made cribs, ping pong paddles, anything made out of bent wood. And so he was successful at doing that before the war. He was also my swimming teacher and also my soccer teacher. But in 1938, the German army invaded Sudetenland, and I know some of you are World War II buffs, so you know that the Sudeten was invaded. It was a German-speaking part of Czechoslovakia. The Czech army was mobilized. My dad was a lieutenant. This sword must have really been useful in fighting the Germans. Unfortunately, there's 7 million Czechs and 70 million Germans. So needless to say, the Czechs didn't do very well, and by 1939, the Germans occupied Czechoslovakia and Prague. So what did this mean? It really meant a dramatic change. It meant that Germans soldiers were everywhere. There were pictures of Hitler. There were flags. People started to be arrested. Jewish families were ordered to report to a railroad station in Prague, the two railroad stations, and from there they were sent to Terezin, which was about a 2.5, 3-hour trip, and from there many were sent to Auschwitz. It also meant that Czech citizens, Christians, non-Jews, had to decide which side were they on. And obviously many Czechs opposed the Nazi occupation. They were unhappy that there were foreign troops there, but many of them found it easier not to do anything. And this whole idea of good people and bad people played off against each other. So what is the Holocaust? I teach a whole course in it, so this will only be a couple of minutes. But essentially, it's the death, it's the murder of 6 million Jewish men, women, and children between 1939 and 1945. In the camps, in the gas chambers, starvation, work, beatings, negligence, you name it. But there were also 5 million other victims, including the physically and mentally disabled and handicapped. That was the first group. Christian clergy and nuns, and there were brave Christian nuns and clergy who opposed Hitler, and many of them wound up being killed. Political prisoners, Jehovah's Witnesses, homosexuals, gypsies called Romani, Russian and Polish army prisoners, and children of interracial marriages. There was an area in the Rhineland where French troops occupied after World War I, and most of those troops were from Africa, French Africa. Many of those men married German women, they had interracial children, many of those interracial children were sterilized. So how to understand the Holocaust? Very quickly, it's tough to. Now, let me just find out, any of you study any aspect of the Holocaust? Could I show up here? What, like Anne Frank or Elie Wiesel's Night? What, Night? How many of you read Night? Okay, so you have a good idea of what the camps were about and what Auschwitz was about. So one way to understand the Holocaust is there were basically 5 major groups. Perpetrators, Hitler and the Nazi Party, victims, bystanders. The largest group in Europe during the World War II and the Holocaust were people who stood by. That is, it's easier. Think about it. You know, you're walking around Raleigh or your neighborhood or you're in school and you see something is happening and you have a sense that maybe someone's being bullied, someone's being beaten up, someone's gonna, one group is picking on another group. Do you get involved? Do you get in there? Or is it easier to cross the street, get out of harm's way, and say, it's not my business, I'm just going to keep trucking? Most people, I think, are bystanders. They don't get involved. And your whole conference here, your 3-day conference, focuses on how to get involved, how to overcome that lethargy and understand what's right and wrong. So, there were some men and women who acted. One group were called the resistors, literally people who resisted the Nazi occupation. Who were they? They attacked German troops, they disrupted supply lines, they rescued and hit down Allied pilots. But there was also Jewish resistance in places like the Warsaw Ghetto, where mostly young men and women, many your age and a few years older, held off the mighty German army for 40 days and 40 nights. Just amazing. In the Warsaw Ghetto, some women smuggled in arms, and women and men used the arms to hold off that army. So think about the courage that it takes to resist in those kind of situations. But even in concentration camps, there was resistance. A quick story. So my parents and I lived about 20 minutes out of Prague itself, and we had a superintendent, Mr. Novak. And I didn't like Mr. Novak very much, because he usually had alcohol in his breath. But I played with his two kids, and we were friends. But I tried to avoid him as much as possible. And during the war, the superintendent would disappear for a couple of days, then he came back. And he was sort of a grouchy, had a mean temper. I didn't like the guy. Well, it turns out that I learned after the war that he was a member of the partisans. And he was a resistor. He attacked German trains. He blew up supply lines. You know, he's a real hero. And you would never figure that he is one. If you were casting a Hollywood movie, you wouldn't have picked that guy to be the resistor. So you never know. There were also rescuers, brave Christians who saved Jewish lives. They hit children, they protected them at their own risk, because if you were found to protect a Jew, you were in trouble. And for example, Denmark saved almost all of its Jews, so it was possible to do. All right, let's get back to the family story. So my dad and all my relatives are sent to Terezin. In front of each concentration camp, there are the German words, Arbeit macht frei. Anybody know his or her German?
What is that?
Work will set you free.
Say?
Work will set you free.
Work will set you free. What does that mean?
They thought that, they were telling them, I guess, that... I think, in a way, it was kind of like its own form of propaganda, saying that if you help them out and fight their, like, help fight their war, that you would be all right. And obviously, that wasn't true.
Exactly. Did you want that?
No. Yeah. And it was a euphemism. It was baloney. But work will make you free. Here are the Jews arriving in Terezin, and every week out of Prague, about 1,000 Jews were sent from Prague to Terezin. So was my dad. So my father spent about 2 years doing what's called slave labor before he was sent to the camp. When he was sent there, he and others were helped to, they had to build a railway. So it was very, very difficult work. Very little food, not enough protein. One of the contradictions of the camps were that people worked hard, but they weren't fed properly, they weren't trained. So it was a matter of time until they could no longer do the work. But somehow he did survive. And if you talk to survivors, they'll say it was as much luck as perseverance that they did survive. Now, what about me? I was in grammar school in Prague, and this is my second grade school. We have two teachers, Mrs. Prochaska and Mr. Novak. And interestingly enough, he taught science and math, and she taught Czech and also German. What's meant, and here I am, visually handwriting. This is the class bully, Joseph. every classroom has a bully. And he called me a dirty Jew a couple of times, and we fought. He was stronger than me. I got a bloody nose out of it. I was sent down to the principal's office, right? That's what happens when there's a fight. But he called me a dirty Jew because his parents were anti-Semites. You know, so you learn a lot from your parents. But what's missing from this photo is the front of the classroom, where we have pictures of Hitler and the German flag. So every day we were reminded that we were being occupied. And here I am. Notice the latest writing implement. You have to dip this in the inkwell. And guess what happens when second graders dip their pens in inkwells that are not exactly there? They drip, right? And you get it on your papers, on your sleeves, on your arms, everywhere. One story. This is the SS, the most dreaded part of the German army. So we lived, as I said, about 20, 25 minutes out of downtown Prague. One morning I get on the tram. We had trams in Prague. And I sit down like a good second grader. I pull out my book and I'm reading. And suddenly I look down and I see a pair of black boots, shiny black boots. My eyes go up and I see a gray-green uniform. They continue up and I see the cap with the skull bones and the German eagle. And I see that an SS officer standing in front of me. And he yells at me in German, "Get up and give me your place." And I was petrified. I didn't know what to do. So of course, I packed my bags, I put them into my knapsack, and I went away as far as possible. My father was missing at that time. He was doing labor. And I had all of these paranoid thoughts that somehow the officer knew where my father was, or that if I didn't move quickly enough, and I'll get my father into trouble. And I, you know, like a second grader, you just go crazy. And I really was shaking when I got to school, and Mrs. Prokoska took me aside. She saw how nervous I was and said, "No, he doesn't know. He just wanted a place to sit." But those kinds of scary things during the war. And the Germans were around all the time. And I think my major feeling during the war was fear and uncertainty. You don't know what's happening. I asked my mother, "Where's my dad?" She said, "He's on a business trip." Well, he was a businessman, so that sort of made sense. But I really didn't know. The other thing that happened is we have food shortages. So as the war progressed, there was less and less food. And a quick, sort of a funny story now, was that on Saturday mornings, I and my friends used to ice skate on the river. The river froze up, so we played a little bit of hockey. And one Saturday morning, we played, I don't know, for a couple of hours. We were all hungry. There was a hot dog stand by the side of the river. We all went over there, and we had hot dogs. In Czech, they're called parkys, P-A-R-K-Y-S. And the guy who sells them, they're like very much larger than hot dogs. He takes them out, he boils them. He takes a sharp knife, he cuts it in half, and then he cuts it in another half. So you get a section, and he puts slices a piece of rye bread around the hot dog, and he smears mustard. Great. When you play hockey for 2 hours, that's a wonderful, wonderful treat, right? Because you're really hungry. So the vendor says, "Okay, that's going to be 5 crowns each and a coupon." Well, every kid had the crowns. 5 crowns is, in those days, 20 cents. But nobody had the meat ration coupons. Well, my mother packed meat ration coupons in my bag. So like a hero, I gave the guy all, you know, the meat rations I had. I got home, my mother was very, very upset. Basically, we used up 1 week's meat rations feeding, you know, 4 or 5 hockey players. But that was part of the existence. We also had some bombings. Most of the flights by American and British Air Force. But there were 2 bombings, one particularly in 1945. We went down to the basement of the school. There were explosions. I heard the fire engines and the police. And it's a long story, but a church was hit, one hospital, several hundred people died, and it was a scary time. But throughout all of this, my Catholic grandparents, Antonin and Zdenka, were a rock of support. And my grandmother, no matter how bad food shortages were, every Sunday she would be able to make a chicken meal or pork. She would go out to the country and trade either money or clothing or jewelry for some food. So that was wonderful. My grandfather was a, you know, lovely guy, and every Sunday at 5 o'clock, we would sit down in the living room, me and my 2 cousins, and my grandfather would put on the BBC, British Broadcasting, from London. And at 5 o'clock Sunday evening, they would start with the overture to Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. Da 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 da, da 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 da, da 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 da, da 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 da. Their imitation, but that's the images. And the chimes of Big Ben, and they had a broadcast in Czech from London. And so my grandfather would roll out a map of Europe, and I remember being there the night that the Allies landed in Normandy. And my grandfather had a map of France, and he showed what was happening, and he was picking up the information from the radio station. Well, I had what's called cognitive dissonance. You know cognitive dissonance? When you sort of get two different views of the same phenomenon, right? Two different stories about the same thing. So my teachers, Monday through Friday, were told us, the kids, that the Germans are winning, the mighty German army is advancing, they will conquer, it's only a matter of time. Sunday, my grandfather says, the Germans are losing, the Allies are winning. Well, of course, I prefer the second story. It also meant that my dad would come back from camp. So, now, I talked about victims and resistors, and I'm going to mention several members of my family who were and are my heroes. These are two brothers, Jan Marcus and Thomas Marcus, both Jewish. They and their parents were sent to Auschwitz. They spent 2 years in Auschwitz. The parents were killed, but the two boys survived. And towards the end of the war, the Germans were trying to evacuate the camps and send people back to Germany. These two guys were on a train from Poland to Germany. And they jumped off the train. Just amazing. They apparently the train stopped in an area that they thought they knew, Czechoslovakia. They rolled off, and they hid from December of 1944 till May of 1945. An amazing story. They've both been interviewed by Schindler and a part of that the documentary. But this is Jan, the older one by 4 years. On his marriage day, and this is Thomas. So, not all victims, some victims became resistors. Another resistor is another uncle, Kurt Fanta, and his wife, Malvinka. So the Czech army, after being defeated, some went to England, and some went to the Soviet Union. He was a socialist, he went to the Soviet Union, he fought with the Soviet army, he was wounded, she was a Soviet nurse, and she nursed him back to health. It turned out later they were both Jews, and they survived. And here's my mom and dad, and this is me, after the war. And the third relative was Dr. Zdeněk Steiner, who's over here. This is a Czech squad that fought with the British. And they had their own squadron. And Steiner then changed his name to Stevens because he was afraid that if he was ever shot down, he didn't want to let the Nazis know that he was a Jew. Meanwhile, my dad, the Soviet Army liberates Terezin. And the happiest day of my life, May 8th, 1945, my dad comes back. He jumps off a Russian truck. He's still in one piece and still wearing the star, the yellow star that every Jew had to wear. And he came back, so our family was reunited. We spent another 3 years. It took us 2 years to get an American visa. And it's a long story, but the Czech quota after the Second World War is very small. So we arrived in November 1948 in the middle of the evening. And I saw the Statue of Liberty all lit up, and I saw downtown Manhattan with the tall buildings. It was amazing, just amazing. And then my uncle met us at the boat the next day, and he takes us to an American supermarket, and my jaws drop, and my mother's jaws dropped. You've never seen so much stuff, so much food, so many things to eat and to buy. And 60 years later, here I am with our son Michael. Sorry. My wife, who's sitting in the back, took the photograph. Michelle, are you here? If you need photographs, thank you, she's terrific. And a wonderful source of support. So here we are in Terezin, saying hello to my grandmother, his great-grandmother. Our son is now a third-grade teacher in Washington, D.C., in Petworth, in a bilingual school. His family can English. And he's the proud papa of Jackson Oliver Stein. Jackson Oliver Stein was born 1 month ago. We were just up there this past weekend, and they're doing a great job. So that's my third-grade teacher. And this is the last slide. I know that you're talking about change and democracy. Here's our attempt, our Center for Holocaust and Genocide and Human Rights Education. Make the world a better place. Get involved with local organizations, refugees, literacy, young children, Hispanic community, hunger relief, home construction, or with national and international organizations. So if there is one left, get involved, to be vigilant, to be aware of what's happening, and think of the others, not just yourself. Thank you.
You have about a week, so I can answer you. I'm staying over. It's a great question. I wish there were a simple answer. I guess it's to be vigilant to educate ourselves and to read. You know, in the morning session, this is Dr. Dowling. So we know that the average American family spends $40 on books per year, but $470 for toys. Well, that means a lot of folks aren't reading, or they're, you know, so I think education is crucial. And trying to put yourself in the other person's shoes. In sociology, we call it empathy. That is literally, put yourself in the other person's. What is it like to be that person, or to be homeless, as we saw with Michelle, the young woman? What does it mean to lose employment? What does it mean to be discriminated because of race, sexual orientation, nationality, income? You know, especially those of us who are leading fairly comfortable lives, can we look beyond our own bailiwick to see what those folks must be dealing with and what can we do to help. That's at least part of the answer.
So this is probably a silly question, but did you ever personally did you ever personally see or meet Elie Wiesel?
Did I meet him? As a matter of fact, sorry. Great question. Elie Wiesel, as you know, did you read Night? Yeah. I met him with about 150 other people at Columbia University when he spoke about his experiences. And he's a very impressive guy with a D. He was a longer Romanian accent, you know. But he's very intense, very, you know, he looks in your eyes, dark eyes, and you feel like, okay, man, this is, you know, he's telling the truth, I better shape up. And you know, what he's done is just amazing. Not only to survive, but to champion Holocaust education. You know, and he pretty much responsible for the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, D.C. Have any of you been there? With grad schools? What, in a nutshell, what was your reaction?
Overall, my reaction was like, how did this happen, and horrifying that anybody could do such a thing to another human being. Like, we're all the same species. How can we treat a certain group like they're animals? They're not. So they have brains, they have feelings.
You know, at some level, and I think other people would agree, it's hard to understand. It's almost impossible. But hate, things like anti-Semitism or racism, have been around for a very long time. This country, you know, slavery was and the economic vehicle throughout the South. The Civil War, and you know, I think even though we have a biracial president now, and we've made a lot of advance, racism continues. Well, why? You know, and that's a very complicated question, right? There's no easy answer. We see the beatings virtually every week. There's some other police action there. Why? Why did the Holocaust happen? Well, part of the answer is anti-Semitism existed in Europe for about 2,000 years. So a lot of people didn't buy it, but some did. And we would have to look, as a sociologist, at institutions. What do schools teach us? What do churches and temples and mosques teach us? What does television teach us about tolerance or intolerance? What are the programs on TV? Is there ever a program where the good guy wins and triumphs in cartoons? But it's more interesting to look at the problems. You know, one guy deciding that it's transgender. It sells, right? You see Bruce's pictures on the cover of Vanity Fair. Everybody's jumping off the shelf. Fine. But there are other issues also. And what else? What does a transgender person deal with? I'm meandering a little bit. But it takes a lot of vigilance.
Other questions? We have time for about two more.
There's a hand all the way to the back, young woman.
Oh, God.
I think we can all agree that reading is really important, but do you have any like big suggestions for books that we can read to learn more about this?
Excuse me, I'm out of camera.
You're good.
What? Say it again. What?
Books to read.
Oh, yeah, books to read.
Education is key, so what could they read?
Okay, down here is our website, www.holocaustspeakersbureau.org. We have a website, and we certainly have things on there. You could also contact me through there. My email is Stein, Peter J,
stein@gmail.com, Stein, Peter, the letter J, at Gmail. There's so many books to read, but I would recommend, to answer your question and this young woman's question about the Holocaust, a book by Christopher Browning called Ordinary Men. Ordinary Men. It's about 150, 160 page paperback. And he tries to answer the question that she posed, why did good people do bad things? The Ordinary Men was a reserve battalion of policemen from Hamburg who were sent to Poland to kill Jewish men, women, and children. They tanked them up, they got them drunk before they went on these killing sprees. But it's written in a very conversational tone. He did a lot of interviews. I think it will give you some good insights. The one other one, Yehuda Bauer, B-A-U-E-R, Yehuda Bauer, History of the Holocaust, written at the high school and college freshman level. Very good overview of the history of the Holocaust. Okay.
Gentlemen, yeah.
Hey, I would like to say, I would like to applaud you for how you did that, the presentation. But what I really wanted to ask is, because I really considered that you probably been through a lot of tragedies and stuff like that. A lot of people here nowadays, if we went through something like that, we'd be traumatized. We wouldn't be able to speak out and do something about that. And that's why I really wanted to apply for it. And personally, thank you for it. But my question was, what is the biggest takeaway that you could probably influence us or encourage us to do something about local issues that's going on that can be just as empowering and impactful that you would like?
Great. Thank you. Wonderful questions. I just need 3 days to answer that one. I think to get involved and to dig deep. You know, we can read the headlines, this is happening, and it looks like this is the problem, right? And then you do some more digging, well, that's just one of 12 problems. Or that's not really a problem, it's really something else. This is what sociology does. It digs deeply into things. To read, to talk to people, to interview, to go visit, to, you know, get your hands dirty, because we all look for quick answers. Oh, the reason that happened is because this guy. Well, you know, can I give you a silly analogy? It's baseball season, right? And the season will be over, and some teams will not do well. What does management do? Fires the coach. Right? It's the coach's fault that the shortstop couldn't field the ball, or that the third baseman could never hit in the clutch. Right? It's much more complicated. And I think we tend to do that in everyday life. We look for a quick answer. Most answers are more complicated. That's all I can offer right now. And you know, the thing is, I've also, for years and years and years, I didn't do anything about the Holocaust. Then I came across the Holocaust denier, and this is something, an important piece. Increasingly, Holocaust survivors are dying. They're in their 80s, they're in their 90s, and they will not be with us forever. And my concern is that as their memories fade, they will be replaced by deniers, people who said, either it didn't happen, or it wasn't so bad, or they're exaggerating it. And I think it's important for you folks to keep that in the forefront. And remember that we're talking about one Holocaust from 70 years ago. Since the Holocaust ended, there have been countless genocides in Rwanda, in Yugoslavia, in Darfur. And they continue. Oh boy. Where was it? There was a conference in South Africa. He's been indicted by the International Criminal Court. He was supposed to be arrested by the South African police. He wasn't. He got on a plane. He got out. How come? What happened? So these genocides continue, and we have to hold people responsible. Bad people have to be held accountable for their deeds.
All right, we're going to have that be our last question, but and Maddie's going to close us out here, but just so you know, we have a 15-minute break, and I know a lot of you would like to come up and meet Dr. Stein and maybe have your pictures taken, and so we'll have 15 minutes. And
I'll hang out
here. He's a rock star, so he's going to hang out with us, okay? So thank you again for that very much. It's getting better.